baptized. Let us also come to receive living waters and gifts of life. Good morning.
Good morning.
I'd like to welcome you here this morning. It truly does give me joy to see your faces in person, although we live a lot on Zoom these days, but I'd just like to welcome you. It's been a hard week, a strange week. A lot has happened. That's shocking, heartbreaking, and all that. Today, I want to invite you to be together in the presence of God this hour and to look at what is good and holy and true. And who is the God that we serve? And what does that say about who we are? Can we do that for this hour? Let's do that. I'm starting a sermon series today for the rest of January called Called by God. And it is about stories of people who are called to serve. And we're starting out with none other than Jesus himself today and the story of his baptism. So I want to mention a couple of schedule things. The Monday night Bible study is meeting tomorrow night on Zoom. And next Monday there's a church council meeting. So we'll skip the Bible study until the following week, but we are meeting tomorrow. Next Sunday, our outreach team is going to be preparing lunches, bag lunches, for the Hodges Avenue Ministry in our social hall. So they invite you to come and help put those lunches together for people in need, 75 lunches, and that is one of our January mission projects. So you're invited to help with that. And also in January, we're collecting socks, new socks for people who need them. I see we already have a good pile in the middle room, so thank you to those who have contributed to that, and we'll keep collecting. So those are the things I wanted to mention in terms of schedule, and we will continue now with our worship.
Please stand for the call to worship. Come, let us drink from living waters.
We remember the gift of the water of baptism.
God invites us to the cleansing waters.
We need forgiveness and a way to start again.
Let us visit once again the rivers of grace.
And remember who and whose
we are. Amen. Let's take a few moments to greet each other with signs of peace.
Thank you.
first scripture lesson this morning is from Isaiah 43, verses 1 to 7. But now, this is what the Lord says. He who created you, Jacob, he who formed you, Israel, do not fear, for I have redeemed you. I have summoned you by name. You are mine. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you. When you pass through the rivers, they will not sweep over you. When you walk through the fire, you will not be burned. The flames will not set you ablaze. For I am the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, your Savior. I give Egypt for your ransom, Cush and Seba in your stead. Since you are precious and honored in my sight, and because I love you, I will give people in exchange for you, nations in exchange for your life. Do not be afraid, for I am with you. I will bring your children from the east and gather you from the west. I will say to the north, give them up, and to the south, do not hold them back. Bring my sons from afar and my daughters from the ends of the earth. Everyone who is called by my name, whom I created for glory, whom I formed and made.
Would you pray with me now the prayer for illumination? Let us pray. O God, teach us your truth and increase our faith as we hear your word today. Amen. I'm going to read to you from the Gospel of Matthew. Would you stand, please, for the Gospel reading? There is a typo in the bulletin. I'm actually going to be reading to you from Matthew chapter 3, verses 1 to 17. In those days, John the Baptist appeared in the wilderness of Judea, proclaiming, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven has come near." This is the one of whom the prophet Isaiah spoke when he said, "The voice of one crying out in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make his path straight." Now John wore clothing of camel's hair with a leather belt around his waist, and his food was locusts and wild honey. Then the people of Jerusalem and all Judea were going out to him, and all the region along the Jordan, and they were baptized by him in the river Jordan, confessing their sins. But when he saw many Pharisees and Sadducees coming for baptism, he said to them, "You brood of vipers, who warned you to flee from the wrath to come? Bear fruit worthy of repentance. Do not presume to say to yourselves, 'We have Abraham as our ancestor,' for I tell you, God is able from these stones to raise up children to Abraham. Even now the axe is lying at the root of the trees. Every tree, therefore, that does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire. I baptize you with water for repentance, but one who is more powerful than I is coming after me. I am not worthy to carry his sandals. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire. His winnowing fork is in his hand, and he will clear his threshing floor and will gather his wheat into the granary, but the chaff he will burn with unquenchable fire." Then Jesus came from Galilee to John at the Jordan to be baptized by him. John would have prevented him, saying, "I need to be baptized by you, and do you come to me?" But Jesus answered him, "Let it be so now, for it is proper in this way to fulfill all righteousness." Then he consented. And when Jesus had been baptized, just as he came up from the water, suddenly the heavens were opened to him, and he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and alighting on him. A voice from heaven said, "This is my Son, the Beloved, with whom I am well pleased." Here ends the video. You may be seated. The you remember it. And many of us don't, because we were just little babies at the time. What does it mean that our parents took us to church and a pastor sprinkled water on us? We baptize people of all ages in the United Methodist Church. And we believe it's a gift from God that we can offer people, whether they are young or old. And we think that when we baptize someone, something special is happening with that water. We believe we are giving a gift to that person of water and the Spirit. We call baptism a sacrament. We only have two sacraments in the United Methodist Church, baptism and communion. In a sacrament, you take something ordinary, like water or bread, and you ask God to bless it and make it holy. And we believe that when we share it, we are sharing a gift of Spirit. The Gospel of Matthew says that Jesus was about 30 years old when he began his public ministry. That's Luke actually gives his age, so he was 30 years old. Before that, he was just known as the son of the carpenter Joseph. We don't know much about Jesus' first 30 years. We do know that about age 30, he decided to go and find John the Baptist. He had to leave his hometown to do that. John is baptizing at the Jordan River, and Jesus is from Galilee, so he had to walk over 50 miles to get there. This is not something you do by accident. You have to make a plan. You have to make a decision to walk 50 miles to see someone. And we might wonder what Jesus was thinking when he made that choice. I'm going to go to the Jordan to find John. And why was he doing it now at age 30? Why not sooner? You know, in today's world, we expect people to get on with their careers before age 30. And many people find it takes longer than that. I'm sure Jesus had many friends and well-meaning relatives who were pushing him to get married, you know, have some children, start a family. But when the time was right for him, about age 30, he went to the Jordan to find John. What we do know is that John was there. He was baptizing many people. And when Jesus came, he was a bit reluctant. Should I baptize you? John knew who Jesus was. He's a holy man. He knows holiness when he is in the presence of it. And we do know that Jesus' baptism by John was a new beginning for him. It was a turning point. It represented a change in his life. Before that, he was a private person. After that, he begins his public ministry. You could say Jesus' baptism is like a commissioning. It is an anointing. Jesus will now go out to fulfill his mission. You could say it's like an ordination. You could say it's like a coronation. He now has awesome responsibility to serve the people. We call it an anointing, and the tradition of anointing in the Hebrew scriptures, you anoint something that is being set apart for holy work, for God's purposes. And only very special people were anointed. Priests were anointed. Kings were anointed. They also anointed objects. They would anoint things that were to serve on the altar and things that were to be used only for God's work. You could compare Jesus' baptism even to an inauguration. We'll be seeing one of those soon. He is given a new power, a new authority, a new set of responsibilities. He has the job now to set standards, to give commands and instructions, and to lead the people in the way that they should go. He has an obligation to set an example by his own behavior. He will be expected to prioritize the needs of others and not to prioritize his own desires. This all comes together in an inauguration. Have you watched any of the inaugurations of past presidents? You know that it can be a very long, drawn-out affair, and it's not really meant to be exciting. Nobody really watches the whole thing through. There are processions and speeches and military review and formalities, and when it's finally done, you know that there has been a change, something has happened. When Jesus was baptized, it was a much humbler event. No one delivered Jesus in a limo. He didn't have armed escorts. Nobody knew he was important, except for John. There were crowds there, but they weren't there to see Jesus. They came to see John and to be baptized by him. But something amazing happened when Jesus came out of the water. Our passage tells us that when Jesus came out of the water, the heavens opened up. He saw the Spirit of God descending upon him like a dove, and a voice came from heaven. This is my Son, the beloved, in whom I am well pleased. What an amazing moment. It was a powerful moment of the presence of God. And the three persons of the Trinity, all together in one place, the voice of the Father from heaven, the presence of the Holy Spirit like a dove and the Son, all in one place at one time. It was a great moment of love. How wonderful it must have been for Jesus to hear that voice from heaven say, "This is my Son, the Beloved. With you I am well pleased." What a powerful moment. You know, how many of us human beings would love to hear that from a parent, right? "I'm proud of you. I love you." Sometimes we never get to hear it. But this was a powerful moment. And the Spirit has descended upon Jesus. He has received a gift of Spirit. And this is what he will need to do the mission that he is called to do. It is a day that makes Jesus who he is and who we know him to be. If you could ask Jesus to list the top most wonderful moments in his life, I'm sure the baptism would be way up there at the top or near the top. The day he felt all that love and affirmation and power from heaven. Jesus needed that gift of Spirit. He needed it for all the things that he would do later, for the miracles, for the calling of disciples, for the crowd-stirring preaching and teaching that he did, for facing his enemies and their harassment, and for facing the cross. He was ready for all that because he had received the gift of the Holy Spirit. If you were baptized, some would pray that you would receive the gift of the Spirit through the water. We believe that in our baptism, we have some similarities to Jesus. We receive our calling and we receive the gifts to carry it out. Our baptism is a little different because we need repentance and forgiveness for our sins, which Jesus didn't need. But in other ways, our baptism is very similar to Jesus. Every one of us is called by God to serve in some way. In our baptism, God has given every one of us spiritual gifts to use in that service. We are called and commissioned. In our baptism, we find out who we are. There's a story about Martin Luther, the great Protestant reformer of the 16th century. And the story is that he said, "When you wash your face in the morning, remember that you are baptized." Now historians are saying, well, maybe he wasn't the first one to say that. Maybe, I don't know who said it first, but I like it. When you wash your face, remember that you are baptized. There's a movie about Martin Luther where he's washing the face in the morning and he says, "You are baptized. Now act like it." "I've been baptized. Now I need to act like it." baptism and all that it means. Remember that you are loved by God in heaven. Remember in your baptism that God has given you a purpose. Remember that you were baptized and you have gifts to offer. Remember that you were blessed with the gift of Spirit, and that is what is going to get you through. Remember that you are anointed for holy work. Remember that you have been blessed to be a blessing. Remember your baptism and be thankful. Praise God for the gifts of water and the Spirit. Amen. Let's listen now and hear, "Shall We Gather at the River." Children's ministry, and that was ministry has slowly grown, as our Sunday school ministry has. So thank God, praise God for that, even though we can't get together. More children are participating, and I think that's really wonderful. So let's pray for the children who get the click bags, that they can be blessed by that. They're learning about God, and that's wonderful. And of course, we want to keep praying for the COVID situation, which is very severe right now. Just heartbreaking numbers of deaths going on, and we need to keep praying. So let us pray together, Lord, as we turn our attention to the Lord's presence with us. Oh God, we feel sometimes very small in light of the problems of the world. What can we do? What can we offer? We think of our nation and all the struggles, the harsh things that have taken place, the evil things that have taken place. And we know that we need your grace and mercy now. We need you. Lord God, help us to know what our part is, what we can do to cross lines of division, to find our way through. We pray for our leaders, our elected leaders, for their safety, our civil servants. May they do their jobs to the best of their ability. We pray for our communities, our people. May we learn what it truly means to be a citizen and to contribute to the future together, to our democracy. Oh Lord, help us to know when to comfort people, know when to challenge people, know when to be quiet and when to speak. You are the comforter of the disturbed and the disturber of the comfortable, Lord. We thank you that you have given us gifts of spirit. Your spirit is with us. You have given us the strength to do what we are called to do. You are present with us no matter what, and we thank you for that. Let us remember that you are holy. Let us remember not just to look at the bad things, but to look at you, your goodness and your truth. Oh God, we pray for people who are struggling with illness right now. We pray for your healing and strength to be with them. We pray for Rosalie, who is in hospice now. God, be with her and those who love her. Pray for her husband, Dennis, in chemo. Give him strength, Lord. Give him strength. May love hold him up. Lord, we pray for Mario, who is trying to find a way home, and ask your grace for him, that he will find a solution. We pray for our leaders who are working on in healthcare, working on helping people to stay well, trying to healthcare available to those who need it. They are tired, Lord. They are worn out. We ask your strength for them. Oh God, we're thankful that you have so many times answered our prayers and blessed us. We pray for the children who will be getting clickbacks, Lord. We ask that they will learn about you, that they will grow in spirit, that they will discover thank you for those diligent workers who have been working with the children, who have been working with the outreach projects. Thank you, we have opportunities to be in mission to our communities, even in this time when we have to keep distances, when we have to be so careful. Oh God, we pray for the homeless, for the jobless, for those who struggle to survive. Hold them up, Lord. Get them through. We ask your grace for them, and we ask you to show us what we can do. We thank you for the gift of the water, for the gift of baptism, that you have loved us and called us and equipped us. We are your people, and we are called to serve, and we thank you for that. What an honor it is to be able to serve you. Help us to find direction in the things you would have us do. Help us to discover our gifts, to discover each of us the purposes that you give us, so that we might carry them out. Let us carry them out in joy, Lord, no matter what. Today we remember the baptism of Jesus and all that he did to serve, all that he did out of love for us. The great power that he showed and the grace that he offered. And we pray today as Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. We have heard the word of the Lord, the story of Jesus' baptism. And we have been given the gift of water and the Spirit. Let us remember that with joy and act like it. And act like it. You have received the gift of water. Act like it. Let us commit ourselves to serving and to using our God-given gifts to bless others. You know, God gives us gifts, and it's not just for us to enjoy. It's so that we can reach out and bless other people with them. So I encourage you to, when you wash your face, remember who you are. Remember who you are. If you have brought an offering with you today, you can place it in the offering plate that is in the front on your way out. If you're worshiping with us online, we offer you to find our webpage, and there's a button there to give through PayPal. We thank you for your gifts and your faithfulness. And because of your gifts, we are able to be in ministry together to the world in so many different ways. We thank you for that. I'll invite you now to stand and to pray to me the prayer of dedication. O God, of all that we have and all that we are is a result of your love and divine grace. Bless these gifts, and let our lives be a thank offering to your grace and love. Amen. May you see. Thank you. our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.